So it feels like years since I've seen you.
Don't say that.
Well, it's years since you've seen me, but
you've been seen.
I've been seen.
You've been around.
I have.
Well, you had this huge explosion with Maria Full of Grace, and then you kind of seem to have gone back to television for a while.
No, I didn't go back to television.
A misnomer.
I had a series of film projects that I tried to get off the ground, and Hollywood said no, and so I said, okay, fine, I'll go to Albania.
So you just kind of hit the system at the wrong moment in terms of making movies that were the kind of movies you
wanted
to make?
Well, it was, let's just say it was a very long learning moment for me about the way the system works. I wrote a script which I enjoyed writing quite a lot that involved research and going to Iraq and interviewing truck drivers who worked for Halliburton there, and tried to get that made, but it was not the moment to get a movie about Iraq made, as it turns out. And it was also the moment when that company, Warner Independent, and many other independent divisions of studios also went under, so it was not a great moment in filmmaking history. And then tried to get a movie made based on an adaptation of a book called The Fortress of Solitude by Jonathan Latham, and that was around the time of the financial collapse. So those two and a number of other things that I tried to make, just it didn't seem to gain traction. And in many respects, this new film that's in Albania is a response to that. It's about taking back control and saying, okay, I'm going to go back abroad and make something small and make it in a way that I can control. And ironically, it was infinitely easier to get the financing for that than it would have been for anything here in the studio system.
So there was a moment where you said, okay, screw it, I'm going back to doing something I can get my hands around?
Well, was partly a question of having control over it. It was partly just I had an inspiration for an idea for a film I could see very clearly, and it was something I wanted to do. And let's just say it wasn't, if I'd had the idea to do this film at a different juncture, I might have maybe shelved it or put it on hold because it wasn't time that wasn't going to go away.
Right.
But the moment when I had the idea coincided with a moment when I was also not wanting to get caught up again with yet another project in development. And so it led very seamlessly to my going off and doing this.
So in this whole period, did you find a community of like-minded, like-suffering, independent-minded filmmakers?
There's a permanent community of like-minded, suffering, independent filmmakers. We never go away. But, you know, independent film in the last few years has been, in some respects, embattled, and in some respects, that fact of having to really face a changing tide in what's going on in the film industry has also caused people to find new and interesting ways to get their films made. So in some senses, it's very depressing, and in other senses, it's very inspiring.
Well, you're with IFC, so that's, I mean, the last film was at Fine Line / New Line, when they all existed, which is a different animal, I guess. This is, IFC kind of has different priorities in terms of getting what audience it's chasing and how it's chasing them, I guess, has changed a lot over the last 5 years.
Well, IFC, among the films that IFC distributes, they do a number of art house films, foreign language films, and so in many respects this film feels like a very good fit. And I think they understand the market that we're going for, they understand what the actual possibilities are for a film like this, and they know how to do it, they know how to get it out there. So that's very encouraging.
And the mixture of VOD and theatrical is happy for you, comfortable for you, or do you even think about it?
It's new for me, and I will, you know, I put my film in their hands, and they've done it capably before, so I trust their decisions. We're not doing a day and date, but there will be a much smaller window of time before it goes on to VOD than there traditionally would have been.
So you, the Albanian experience, had you been there years before? How did you end up kind of falling upon Albania?
I had never been to Albania. I had heard about Albania. I was fascinated by the idea of Albania, mostly because no one knew anything about Albania.
Because your background involves a lot of world travel.
I've traveled a lot, and I spent time in Eastern Europe. I lived for a year in Czechoslovakia when that country still existed as Czechoslovakia. And I'd traveled for a summer through Poland and Hungary and through Central Europe. But Albania has always been, or for the last 50 years anyway, been sort of off limits. I mean, under communism, the dictator was very, very reclusive in the sense that the country was completely cut off there was a good, within that 45 years of communism, there was 20 years where there was no contact even either with Eastern Europe, Soviet bloc, or with China, and journalists couldn't go in or out, and people really knew very little about it, and communism ended in the early 90s. And so it was sort of on my radar as, gee, isn't that a curious place, and it'd be interesting to find out more about that. And so when I heard about this tradition of blood feuds, it was fascinating to me, and it was one of those aha moments in reading about it when I thought, oh, this would be a really, I can see what the hook for this, for the film would be.
So what's the research like for you on something like that?
On this, the research, and on most things, is about talking to people. It's about finding a way to get myself in a room with the people who have the experiences that I'm interested in, and asking questions and just sitting and listening, and then, you know, taking copious notes. And getting, in this case, into the homes of families who are in northern Albania living in sort of self-imposed house arrest, where none of the male members of the family are leaving the house because some cousin or brother or father has killed someone, and so that means that their extended family owes a life in return. And by tradition, they stay inside the house, partly out of self-preservation and partly out of a form of respect to say, listen, I know that my crazy uncle killed your brother, so we're not going to walk around town and we're not going to flaunt it. And this can go on for weeks or months or years. I met a family that had four sons. The oldest son was 14. And the family had been living in isolation for 15 years. So none of the sons had been to school. And they basically didn't leave their house. They would venture as far as the garden sometimes. I met a number of families like this. And it's really, what one of the things that's most fascinating is the contrast of the fact that people are living like this and yet they have cell phones. In some cases they have, if they're lucky, they have internet. Most do not, but they certainly know about Facebook. And they're, so all this is happening in the context of a modernizing country.
And yet this is, the tradition is, they hold it dear to them in a weird, I mean, it's,
well,
horrifying,
it's,
and yet it seems like they're committed to it.
I don't know if committed is the right word. It's definitely a tradition. It's part of their culture. It goes back many hundreds of years. It's sort of like, you know, talking about the Magna Carta or something like that. It is something that is a core element of Albanian history and culture. And while the vast majority of Albanian society recognizes that this is an outmoded set of traditions, there is still a sort of emotional attachment to this set of customs. It's been, it's referred to as the kanun, and the kanun is, it's now been written and published. You can buy it in book form, but it is basically an oral tradition, and it's a set of rules. And the rules govern everything from commerce and how you trade, to rules of marriage, to rules of hospitality, and also rules of what to do in the event that someone kills someone else. And they're very, very specific, and obviously they come out of specific experiences that people have had. And so what might happen is that some specific thing happens and the elders of the community decide what an appropriate judgment should be, and that then becomes codified and it gets passed down. And but because it's an oral tradition, there's always some leeway and some fuzziness, and applying it is difficult. And all of this takes place, to the extent that people still rely on it, outside of the modern constitutional system. So there is also in Albania a police force and a judicial system, and if someone is murdered, then the police show up and they do an investigation and they try and put that person in prison, but at the same time, the family might be trying to exact its own
form of
justice. Well,
in this story, they do that. They have one member is in prison,
right,
and the father's kind of on the run, hiding,
right,
all of that. So is it part of, is all of this part of modern Albania? And are they both going on at the same time, or is it like there's a part of Albania that's swung off and become modern, and there's a part that's still lingering in this? I mean, is it like Hasidic Judaism or extreme Muslimism, where there are people who believe so strongly in that these rules overwhelm?
It's not in the sense that it's not like you could find a sect of people like with long hair and bushy beards that are wandering around saying, we believe in the kanun and we reject the system, we reject the judicial system. It's not in that sense. It's more that if something happens, everyone is living in modern Albania. You know, there mm-hmm. okay, yes, there are a few villages way on, you know, that are isolated on in mountains, mm-hmm. but you know, everyone's got cell phones and everyone's got a car, and it's a modern society. But if something happens and you scratch beneath the surface, people's beliefs and people's values mm-hmm. are, to some extent, informed by or influenced by the canoe and what this sort of heritage is. Whether or not someone actually uses it to justify taking it revenge depends on who they are and depends mm-hmm. on their specific circumstances. It's not like everyone in Albania is off doing this. But it's also not like you can say, oh, well, it's only those crazy people who right. live in that one region.
But it makes the Scarlet Letter look subtle comparatively. I mean, an entire family essentially has to go into hiding and, you know, stay out of the light.
Right.
Because somebody in the family behaves badly or does something terrible
right.
is an extraordinary level of punishment for a family.
It is. It's declining now, bit by bit. It had an explosion at the end of the 90s in particular. I mean, basically coming out of communism, that mm-hmm. this is something that has existed for hundreds of years, and under communism, by virtue of the way the dictatorship ran, there were no blood feuds. They were absolutely forbidden, mm-hmm. and the government was very effective in making sure that blood feuds simply did not occur. And the government, among the few things that it had to take pride in, was very proud of the fact that it had sort of modernized the country and led Albania out of blood feuds. Well, of course, as soon as communism fell, mm-hmm. there was a power vacuum, and that was part of what caused people to turn back to this system, was that people couldn't rely on the police force or the judicial system to actually do its job, and people either wouldn't get arrested after a murder, or they'd get arrested and then their family would bribe them out of jail. Mm-hmm. And so people would use the canoe as a legitimizing way of saying, okay, mm-hmm. well, then we're this is what gives us the right then to take justice into our own hands.
And the story seems to, you know, currently will go far beyond Albania. As it turns out, right now we've been talking a lot about the Madoff family has been on television lately, mm-hmm. talking about their shame and the son who committed suicide over it. We've been dealing with Iraq and the idea that we created a power vacuum by getting rid of Saddam Hussein and what that's going to happen when we leave. It seems like even in South Central, you know, it's not as much as it used to be, but that whole sense that once somebody has done something to somebody else, that being on the street is dangerous and the bullet can come any time. I mean, there's actually a great documentary by Steve James called The Interrupters this year uh-huh. about Chicago, and very much that people need to be on the street, former gang members trying to stop people from acting in that haste and actually thinking about it before they, you know, are going to take revenge. So the film actually seems to be much bigger than Albania in a way.
Well, I mean, I'm glad that you say that. I think it is. I think one of the things that makes the film interesting is that on the one hand, it allows an audience to see into a country that they don't know anything about, and it's mm-hmm. fascinating, and it's full of all these bizarre contradictions, like people in horse-drawn carts on cell phones. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, at a thematic level, that the movie is universal. It is about two teenagers who are stuck in the crosshairs between the old and the new, and they are themselves trying to figure out their place in this and trying to find a voice. And so in that respect, it's a story of kids growing up. Mm-hmm. And so that gives it a universal quality. And it does also have the universal quality in the sense that it is about bigger themes like, as you mentioned, justice and revenge and modernization and what it means to be a modern democracy in the world today. And so my hope is that in all those ways, the film is both very specific and also universal.
So what was it like to just strap on the film directing hat again after a while?
Well, I mean, as you mentioned, I've been doing some TV in between, mm-hmm. so it's not like I haven't been directing, but...
But it's not your child the same way, you know, when you come
well,
to TV
no,
series.
It's not, but it's hard to compare anything to Albania. Albania feels like a whole other set of circumstances. It's that no amount of directing can prepare you for. You know, there's very little film industry in Albania. Mm-hmm. It meant that we had to bring a certain amount of key crew with us. You know, I was working in a language that I was only just learning. And I think one of the things that was most challenging was that for the first month that I was there and I was doing all this research, it was all very interesting and fascinating at an intellectual level, in the sense that I was interviewing people about blood feuds and pride and anger and retribution and violence and ego and temper.
And are you having to do that quietly?
Or no. No. People, I mean, everyone knows about the blood feuds. No one is trying to stop me from making a movie about it. And there have been other movies within Albania that have been made about it. But I'm having all these conversations as a writer. And so I'm doing all this research sort of at a one step removed. Then when I become the director, then suddenly I'm implicated in Albania in an entirely different way, because now I am trying to do business with people, and I'm trying to get people to show up on time, I'm trying to make them get along, I'm trying to make them respect contracts. And suddenly I am engaging with a certain set of cultural values and attitudes, and that became one of the really challenging things. I mean, that's frequently challenging. That was challenging on Maria Full of Grace, working abroad. That's one of the things that makes it exciting. But it's really difficult to figure out what to do when someone who works on your own crew, who's Albanian, is yelling at someone at the top of their lungs, and you pull the person aside and you say, listen, that's not the way I do business, and you represent me in making this movie, and that's not the way I want you to do business. And they turn to you and they say, but you don't understand. If I don't yell at that person, then they won't respect me, and they're going to run right over us, and they're going to completely take advantage of us. You have to, I'm Albanian, I understand how to negotiate with people. You have to let me do things the Albanian way. And so suddenly you're caught in this difficult position as an outsider trying to make a movie in Albania, figuring out, well, at what point do I say, okay, that person is right and I have to trust them? And at what point do I say, well, even if they're right, that's not the way I want to do things, and I want to try and do things differently. Is that effective? Is that the right thing to do? And are they even reliable, this person on my own team, or are they simply part of this way of doing things? So all of that makes that all of that was far more complicated than figuring out where to put the camera or you know, how to set the shot.
So how did it work out? Was it constantly, I mean, I know that in some countries,
We almost had two blood feuds break out in the course of shooting.
Within your crew?
Not within the crew, within locations. Because what would happen, there was definitely a moment where it felt like life was imitating art, imitating life, where the premise of the movie is that this family gets involved in a blood feud, and the result is that the son, the 17-year-old son, has to stay living inside his house. And the father and the brother both have houses next door to one another on a sort of compound, which is very common in Albania. And so the concept was to find a location like that, which two houses on a plot of land with a garden and a wall around it. And after a lot of searching, I found this perfect locale. And we walked up and knocked on the door, and the family was very, very friendly and hospitable, and they were very happy to help and be part of the film. And we struck a deal and did a contract and started working, and we needed to do certain adjustments to the house. We needed to make renovations, and that was all fine. And we also were going to be shooting in the other house on the property, which was supposed to be the uncle's house. We had like a day of shooting, not even. And they said, no, don't worry. Our cousin is off in Greece working. And about a week and a half before filming, I went to the set to see what the production designer was working on and check the progress of things. And I walk onto the property, and I'm walking down this little path. And I should back up and preface that the story in the film is that the blood feud is all sparked by the main character, the father and the son, trying to go down a path with their cart and cross onto a piece of land that used to belong to their family, and being blocked by a neighbor who's put up a fence. So here I am going to visit the location, and I walk onto the property, and I'm walking down the path, and what do I encounter? This guy I've never seen before putting up a fence across the path. I felt like I was in my film, and this was the cousin who was not in Greece, who in fact lived in the next town over and didn't get along with the side of the family that we had been dealing with. Mm. And when he found out that we were shooting, he was damned if he was going to let us take advantage of him. More than anything, he didn't want to have suffer the indignity of having had his cousin negotiate things for him. He wanted the respect of us having come and knock on his door and sit and have coffee with him, and we didn't even know that he existed.
Right.
So the issue that he had was not with us, but it was with his cousin. And there was a week where we thought we were going to lose the location because we were watching this huge schism within the family. And of course, it was a divide that had far predated us. These two sides of the family didn't get along at all. But watching the way it played out was like, after having done a year of research and written the script and done all these auditions, on the a week away from shooting, I'm sitting here watching the actual events transpire in front of my eyes. It was like.
So did you try to negotiate?
We did. The producer, the two producers, one Albanian and one American, tried to be in the room with the two of them, but there was not much role for us. It was really something that they had to work out between themselves. But again, all the complexities made themselves evident in the fact that we couldn't go, for example, to the local mayor because the mayor, because it was a small town, was by clan related to one of the sides of the fight and wasn't viewed as neutral.
So do you see this as ending at some point? Do you think that the modern world will somehow impose itself upon this, or is this?
Well, there's no question that the modern world is in Albania, and there's no question that Albania is changing and making progress. I had a long conversation with the mayor of Tirana, about the capital city, about what he views as the ways in which Albania can move forward. And for him, as a politician, it's very clear that it's about education, it's about building roads and access and transport so that there's more interaction with the outside world, and it's about facilitating technology, all of which are methods of changing mentality and ways of thinking. But these are attitudes that are very deep-seated, and they run very deep. As I mentioned, the communist dictatorship took great pride in ostensibly rooting out blood feuds, but of course, as soon as communism was over, poof, they came back again.
So were you pleased to be finished shooting when you finished shooting?
Let's get out of here. I was happy to go into editing. Yeah, it was a challenging shoot. I mean, it was a very good shoot, and I'm very proud of what we got, but it was, it makes shooting in Los Angeles look like a walk in the park.
So is that, are you waiting, would you be happy for somebody to come along and say, here's a check for, $15 million and go make your movie, or?
Do you have
one? You like, I can make a phone call. No, I can't, actually, but.
Yeah, no, I'm not.
I mean, would you prefer that, or do you like, my is the challenge part of what makes you so great?
Well, my ideal is to do this every other film. I enjoy this, it's what makes me thrive. I like going to foreign places and finding stories that other people aren't necessarily putting on the screen. But I also have a lot of other types of films that I want to make, and I have plenty of projects in development, and I'm worried. It's not like I turn my nose up at the studio system, by far.
Right. So like an Eddie Murphy comedy, and then
sure.
go to
absolutely.
I thought Croatia.
I loved Tower Heist. I thought Brett did a great job.
So you're part of that crew? Are you, are you going to be working on the Oscars coming up?
Did you know that I've invited me to MC the events?
You can do that. I guess you can hand off with Eddie. You can get the next big team. Stiller's not available. You're the next guy they call.
Right. Exactly.
Do you like those movies? I mean, seriously.
Absolutely. I love a good movie. Mm-hmm. I love a movie that's a good story, well told, that's entertaining. Whether that's a thriller or a comedy or a mystery or, what have you.
So you're not an indie snob, you're...
No.
You just like movies.
I just like movies.
Do you still like movies the same way? Do you see movies the same way?
As what?
As before you made them? As before
I don't think anyone who makes... I don't think anyone who makes movies can watch them without letting go of noticing how they're made. I think that's normal.
Mm-hmm.
But...
So is the idea of having all that machinery at your fingertips attractive, or do you think it might get in the way of getting to where you want to get?
Both. not get in the way of where I want to get, but there is both the fantasy of having a lot of trucks and the fantasy of having a 10-person crew.
Mm-hmm.
Both are equally attractive.
And the middle? Is that where you actually live?
You know what? Making movies, that's what's attractive. It doesn't, at the end of the day, you know, getting to actually make movies is what's fun, is being on set and talking to actors and setting the camera and creating a story. That's what's enjoyable. Yes, I do want to have the opportunity to work with different sets of resources, but that's mostly because I think, like most people, I'm just curious and I want to try everything.
So you also had a you've had a bit of an Albanian blood feud over the movie itself and the Albanian Oscar selection this year.
Yeah,
a bit of drama. Is that shocking, or did it seem like an abnormal thing for Albania?
It's disappointing, but it's not shocking. You know, we always there was never any lack of awareness about what the movie was. It's a movie that's shot in Albania and is in Albanian. It's an Albanian story, but I'm not Albanian. And by virtue of the fact that there are not working Albanian cinematographers or editors or production designers, we knew that we were going to have to bring a certain number of key crew with us. And that's true of every film that's shot in Albania, as well as the films shot by Albanian directors. They are bringing in cinematographers and editors from outside of Albania, because that's the way you make a movie in Albania, because the film industry is small. We knew that there it was a long shot just to get agreement within Albania to submit the film. I mean, we made the film and we released it. The most active thing that we did was that we made sure that we released it before the end of September so that it would be technically eligible. And then sort of allowed whatever would happen to happen.
So do you know about their committee in Albania? Do you know how that system works there?
Well, I do now. I've been educated in it. And it's, you
like
know,
it or not.
You know, the committee voted by a majority, a strong majority, to submit the film for the Oscars.
Is it 25 people? Is it 50
it's
people?
Five. It's five. It's five people. Okay. It's an actor, a writer, a director. I can't remember. It's, you know, it's like one of each of the key positions. And it's this committee that's been composed and set by the Film Center. And that committee's names, as per the Academy regulations, was submitted months before.
And do they have
approved.
Like a dozen choices? Are there more than that, more than the dozen movies made in Albania?
No, it's a small number. It's a handful of films. But what happened was that the committee, the head of the Film Center, saw the film at the Sarajevo Film Festival and fell in love with it and immediately came up to me and said, this has to be our submission for the Oscars. And so that was what got the ball rolling. I was like, we need to get the film released in Albania before the end of September so that we can be eligible. He feels passionately about this film. And so if they feel that way and they want to have the film represent them, then we'll do whatever we need to do in order to make that possibility. So the film was released in the middle of September. And the members of the selection committee saw it, and they liked it, and they wanted to vote for it. And they had a question as to whether or not it was technically, on paper, would qualify. And so the head of the Film Center called the Academy and got as much information as he could and was led to believe, I wasn't on the phone call, but his takeaway from the interaction was that the most important thing, notwithstanding whatever regulations were on paper, was that the committee would vote for it and present it and put it forth to the Academy and say, we believe this is an Albanian film, this is the film we want to represent us. And that statement would carry the day. And so they were dismayed and very disappointed when they did that, and then the Academy turned around and said, no, you're wrong, this is not an Albanian film. And the Academy determines that by name counting, effectively. You know, on the form there's it asks for the names of the director, the producer, and the writer, and six key crew positions, and the cast. And we had an all Albanian cast, but we didn't have a majority of Albanians in the crew. We always knew we didn't, and we had told the Academy we didn't, and we were very honest about it. But then the Academy turned around and said, well, there's not enough Albanian participation in the crew. And Albanians felt really upset, because they said, but it's not taking into consideration what the movie is, what the substance of the movie is, because the substance of the movie is about a problem in Albania that is specifically Albanian, The acting style is unusually realistic for Albanian cinema, so people in Albania had a real affinity for the movie. The movie has broken box office records in Albania and is going into its seventh week on screens, and which an Albanian film has never done before in the country. So there's a huge amount of support for the film. So they were very disappointed to have a group of Americans who don't really know anything about Albania tell them what is or is not an Albanian film.
Or theoretically, we haven't seen the film.
They didn't see the film. I can't even. The Academy makes a point of not seeing the film, which I understand because the Academy can't get into looking at a movie and saying, "Well, that house doesn't look really Albanian." So I mean, they wouldn't.
But it's not like the form is that objective, really, either. I mean, it's an objective measure that's a very specific.
It is one possible objective measure that I believe is irrelevant. More to the point, I personally don't believe that the Academy has any business in setting the rules or guidelines for what is or is not the citizenship of a given movie. It is simply not possible for the Academy to come up with one set of rules that will govern the diversity of 60 some odd countries that are all submitting movies. They simply cannot do it. And the way it is currently set up is that those countries, it's a federal system, each of those countries has their own individual committee. They determine on their own merits and processes how and who should constitute the committee, and then that committee chooses a movie. So why should the Academy get involved in the internal politics of a country and how they determine what movie they believe should represent them? It would be like the US government dictating to the countries of the world how they should legislate how citizenship should be defined. Can you imagine the US government telling Iran how they should determine Iranian citizenship for its citizens? I mean, it's not only preposterous, I think it's also arrogant, and I think it's a huge contradiction because the Academy is claiming to do this on behalf of the local filmmaker, to protect the local filmmaker from some outside forces. And yet the Academy is an outside force. And so why not simply respect the local selection committees?
Well, it's an interesting balance because they've created a system in which that's the only opportunity for a foreign language film, in very, very rare circumstances, to be a part of this Oscar season. And part of the award, getting awarded that way, and there are benefits to that, to a movie, and gets, you know, seen, but they've limited it to this one per country, and each country has to pick their choice, make their choice, and then they want to, then they're kind of interfering in that process.
Right.
Because I think the whole system's a little screwy, that, you know, the idea that France and Albania have the same number of films being considered seems to me insane.
Right.
You know, or India, or whatever, they're countries that, you know, somehow it should be balanced. I think that there's an opportunity for a wider selection of films that, you know, cover more ground, and that the nationality really isn't the issue, or shouldn't be the issue so much, but it's what they've set up, and then they kind of want to pull away from it when somebody gets hot about it. Because Israel, it's happened to the Israeli
political. Well, the band's visit was horrifying. Yes. I mean, here was a movie about, precisely about cross-cultural interaction, and anyone who goes to see a foreign movie and likes foreign cinema is the idea of an American audience seeing foreign cinema is about having an experience of another culture and gaining a larger worldwide perspective. And that was, so that's at the heart of wanting, anyone who wants to promote foreign cinema is ostensibly wanting to promote that kind of cross-cultural understanding. And so here's a movie about the subject of cross-cultural understanding, where two different cultures are coming together and the only language they have in common is English. And by virtue of the fact that these characters have to speak English, suddenly the movie is ineligible.
Somebody counted the words on that.
They had a stopwatch. And you know, the Academy will tell you.
It wasn't the Academy that did it.
The Academy will tell you we were really saddened and we were really horrified, and they will say that they will claim that like they're somehow victims, and I don't quite understand how that's the case. I mean, the incongruities and the you know, disparities with which the rules are applied is part of what's frustrating. You know, I haven't seen the Irish submission. I'd be really fascinated to see it because I have a feeling the fact that there was an Irish director who went, I'm not sure where the film was shot, but it was somewhere in the Balkans, and the film is either in Bosnian or Serbian. Obviously, that's a director who I share a lot of affinities with. I appreciate that an Irish director went and did that. But why is an Irish director doing that, and that's considered an Irish film, but it's not in, it's in Bosnian, yeah. and it's with a Bosnian cast? Or Kaurismäki, who's Finnish, makes a movie in France with a French cast and a French crew, but that qualifies as Finnish. But my film that's shot in Albanian, in Albania, about an Albanian subject matter with an Albanian cast, is deemed not Albanian.
Well, it's more and more the case. I mean, there are a lot more filmmakers going to other countries and making their films now and doing interesting work about other countries that are just, you know, having the same problem. And funding is an issue sometimes where, you know, there's seven countries involved. It's gotten very complicated.
Yeah. Yeah. There have been a number of proposals and ways to fix the system. And I think the starting point should simply be that the Academy should take a hands-off position and respect what individual selection committees in the various countries are sending them. Yeah. I think there's a basic issue of respect.
What's interesting is I do think when this all started and the Academy started doing foreign language and they started doing documentary, that there was a degree where these were smaller films with less money involved and you had to protect them, and there was a good intention. And I think that now we've grown past that. And in a way, there's still this kind of parental attitude, as the United States has about many other countries, ironically, an imperialist attitude almost about, you know, taking care of these little movies, when, including the process of voting, where you can't send out DVDs, you have to see it on a screen, you're required to sign in, there's all these limitations, and it keeps things from happening. You know, only 300-400 people vote for foreign language and documentary because of these restrictions of not sending out DVDs, when you don't have to see every American movie to vote for Best Picture.
Right.
You know, it's we've probably grown past this.
Yeah. It's a complicated situation, and my best hope is that there's at least some sort of dialogue. I would hope that the Academy is at least open to having a lively conversation about it and trying to fix the problem.
Yeah, I think they want to fix it. I think their change is hard.
Yeah.
As your movie shows.
Yeah, exactly.
So are you on to the next thing, or are you still?
Yep. Yeah. I'm definitely promoting the film and looking forward to its release in February, on February 24th. Mm-hmm. I'm getting ready to make something new, and I've just written a new screenplay. So.
Something here or something overseas? Or?
Shot here in English.
Shot here in English. Yeah. Wow. It's a whole new Joshua Marston.
Exactly.